At the heart of what we do is exploring limitless possibilities to enrich lives all over the world. Life is precious, and we're in the business of cherishing every precious heartbeat. Every day brings a new reason to better our lives. Something to learn. Something to laugh and enjoy. Something to dream. For as long as there's a dream, there's hope. And as long as there's hope, there's joy in living. Reasons for us to keep every heart happy and healthy. Helping us in our endeavor are the many interventional cardiovascular solutions that we create. At our state-of-the-art facilities, we make our stents and catheters. Wires and needles. German excellence and Indian innovation, backed by credible research. With the unmatched advantage of being the only company with clinical trials data spanning over 10 years for efficacy and safety. And a one-of-its-kind partnership with the German Heart Center, renowned for its pioneering advancements in cardiovascular technologies. It's not surprising we have over 5,000 satisfied clients and a million smiling patients in over 50 countries around the world. We trust good things happen when you follow your heart, because there's an ocean of opportunities to discover. And our journey has just begun. Translumina, exploring limitless possibilities of life.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining the second session of BIC 2020 Maharashtra chapter. We've earlier had a very nice session on CTO tips and tricks, and now we move on to the bifurcation and trifurcation sessions. We have a lot of eminent doctors with us on this panel: Dr. Renu Bansal, Dr. C.K. Ponde, Dr. Ravi Gupta, Dr. Gaurav Verma, Dr. Singla, Dr. Rajit Bhagwat, Dr. Shetkar, Dr. Shirodkar. Thank you all for joining. I would like to introduce Dr. Gaurav Verma, who will be the moderator for the session. Dr. Gaurav Verma is the director at Nasik. He's done the DM from the prestigious KEM Hospital, Mumbai. Dr. Verma has presented many papers in many national and international conferences and has many publications to his name. I want to welcome Dr. Gaurav Verma. Sir, you can please take over the session, and you can call on the presenters and introduce the chairpersons and panelists.
Thank you, Shantanu. And I think we'll have a very good time, and we'll have a very good evening session on bifurcations and trifurcations with case examples as well. We have very eminent panelist and chairperson as well. So to start with, I'll just introduce, do a ritual, which is actually is not required because everyone knows our esteemed chairperson. But to begin with, I'll just introduce Dr. Bansal sir. He's a head of department at JJ Hospital. He has done thousands of angioplasties till date, published more than 150 papers, international and national journals. He has trained more than 120 cardiologists. And he's a renowned postgraduate teacher at the university, and examiner for various other outside university as well, and examiner as well. And he has conducted many exams as examiner. So I welcome Bansal sir to be a chairperson in our meet today. Then we have our other eminent and distinguished faculty, Dr. Bhagwat sir. Dr. Ajit Bhagwat is the director and head of the department at Cath Lab and Interventional Cardiology Department, Kamal Nan Bajaj Hospital at Aurangabad. And he's the only American board certified interventional cardiologist in Maharashtra. So it's a big achievement for us. Then we have other illustrious and quite distinguished, I will say, teacher for all of us, Dr. C.K. Ponde sir, because he is, you know, present in almost all conferences as a mentor and a speaker. And he has a big list of achievements. He had, gold medalists throughout his UG and PG career. He had a fellowship in interventional cardiology and EP from Brisbane, Australia, in from 93 to 97. He's a recipient of many distinguished awards, like Inspiring Cardiologist Award given by the Economic Times in 2020. Then he's at the moment the Vice President of India Academy of Echocardiography, and currently he's working as a consultant and head at PD Hinduja Hospital, Mumbai. So welcome all the eminent chairpersons, and I also welcome all the panelists and speakers for today's meeting. So to begin with, I'll just share a few slides to set the ball rolling and give you a background about the bifurcation, and then we'll call the first speaker for their talk. So we all know that bifurcation is nowadays commonly tackled modality, which was not before. Maybe 10 years back, we were scared of doing left-wing bifurcations or critical bifurcations when the sidebands was big. But nowadays, with improved technology and improved in the scientific knowledge, we are able to tackle these bifurcation stenosis as well. And it, you know, accounts for around 15 to 20% of our coronary lesions. And challenges we all know are because of the side branch patency and increased restenosis over the long term are some issues during the procedural success. Even if we have a good acute success, we are slightly sometimes worried. So we are still searching for the best possible technique for a bifurcation. We all know that provisional strategy has been the default strategy for most of the cases, and that is the way to start with probably. But sometimes we have to take two-strand strategy from the beginning because of the diffuse disease, big caliber size caliber of the vessel. So we sometimes choose two-strand technique. And in two-strand, we have number of techniques. You can see pull-out, tap, crushing, T-stenting, crush, mini-crush, DK crush. But still, the data recently has favored that DK crush is the thing to go. And even in complex bifurcation, they have a very good long-term result. We all know that classical crush versus DK crush, the problem is about the kissing, and kissing is not possible because of the crushing of the sidebrand stunt. So in 15 to 20% cases, we may not be able to kiss nicely. And in the end, is the kiss which matters. So whatever technique, bifurcation, two-strand technique we are choosing, kissing has to be done. For that only reason, DK crush came into existence, and many trials have been done, 1, 3, 4, 5. And they all have shown superiority over the conventional techniques. Either you take it with conventional provisional stenting with QLOT, or the most recent, the DK Crush 5, which has just been published 3 years back, whose data has been published a year back, also 3 year data, in which they have taken vis-a-vis provisional stenting about the unprotected left main bifurcation cases. And they have already proven that ISR rate was quite less as compared to provisional stenting technique in DK crush group. So just to conclude that provisional stenting is the best thing to go ahead to begin with the bifurcation stenting. But if the disease is complex, then DK crush is the way to go ahead. But because of the learning curve, because of the certain issue with the hardware, acute coronary settings, sometimes DK crush is not possible because of complex multi-step approach. So we have devised our own, you know, things to tackle the situation. But the best thing is that we should give the best to the patient and should have a good long-term result. With that, stop short there. Invite the first speaker for today's evening. And what I can see, I cannot see Dr. Anuj is there.
Dr. Anuj Sardar will join us later.
Okay, and then we'll start with Dr. Santosh, is it?
Yes.
So, Dr. Santosh is going to present about left main ostial and distal bifurcation stenting in an elderly male. So, I'll welcome Dr. Santosh Shiradkar, and now over to you, sir. You can take over. Only request is, sir, that you just stick to the time. Don't you know, cross your 10 to 15 minutes, because then we won't be having a discussion time.
Thank you, Gaurav. Hello, am I audible to anyone?
Yes, Santosh, you are audible.
very much. Clear,
no Santosh. Problem. Go ahead.
Yeah. Actually, I would like to thank to everyone, all the members of the who have organized this program, as well as the eminent panelist and chairperson for giving this opportunity to have a discussion on this interesting case, as well as to learn some major tips from the experience of the from their vast experience of the panelist and the chairperson. Thank you, sir. So this is a case of a 76-year-old male. He is a known case of diabetic and hypertension, and he actually presented with us with class 3 dyspnea for almost about a week. And he had daily episodes of nocturnal dyspnea for almost 3 days before he was admitted to us. He there was no history of angina at rest as such. So when he came to us, he was in heart failure, and the hemodynamic parameters of the patient were otherwise okay. He had pulse rate of 90 and blood pressure of 110/70. Except for bilateral basal clefts, the other systemic examination was unremarkable. ECG was a history of QRS pattern in V1 to V4, which was a history of evolved anterior MI. We did his troponin, which was quite high. It was 2,500. And ECO was a history of severe LV dysfunction with regional wall in LAD and circ territory, but with preserved wall thickness. There was mild MR and no evidence of hypertension, pulmonary hypertension. In hospital, he actually had 2 episodes of atrial fibrillation, which required pharmacological cardioversion with cardioran. And one happened a day before angiogram, and after the second one after doing an angiogram. So this was the ECG of AFib. After once we made patient stable hemodynamically, he came out of left LVF and his rhythm was restored. We did his angiogram, and angiogram was. I will just get to the angiogram. So this was right coronary artery. It was showing mid around 50% lesion and distal diffuse disease. This was the left-sided shoots. These are the left-sided shoots. You can see there very well that the left main ostium, whole length of the left main is significantly stenotic, as well as we can appreciate in this caudal view where the ostial LAD as well as ostial circ, they are also significantly tight. So we discussed this particular thing with the patient's relative, considering his all his clinical factors, like he was diabetic, elderly male, hypertensive with severe LV dysfunction, two episodes of atrial fibrillation and everything. And we gave them plan for both CABG as well as alternative as angioplasty. And relative, they were actually, gave them both the pros and cons of both the procedures. And relatives were there, they were not actually willing for CABG. And also we thought that because of his all comorbid conditions, it would be really very difficult for the patient to sustain CABG, a major surgery. And so we planned for an elective left main bifurcation stenting for left main LAD and ostial circ. We actually started with the 6-French JL circ, but it was hitting actually the left main roof and was not allowing wire to cross the lesion. So we had to change it to the 6-French EBU. And then we crossed the circ lesion first, then we the LAD takeoff from the left main was a little difficult to cross, and the angle between left main and LAD was quite wide to cross the LAD lesion. We crossed that, and so these are the shoots after wiring both the branches, and then we pre-directed the LAD ostial lesion with balloon. And then after ensuring that there was a smooth passage of balloon over the entire length of the vein, removed the balloon and we took the shoots. So initially we thought that LAD was left main along with osteoproximal LAD was significantly diseased. So also we thought that there was a after ostial lesion there was plaque in the proximal LAD. So we wanted to cover that entire thing. So we took a longer stent. 338 stent initially to to cover both lectern as well as LED, but despite multiple attempts, we couldn't negotiate the stent. So again, we took 2.5 NC balloon. We thought that there probably was a calcium spicule which was obstructing the pathway of stent. So we pre-dilated that with the 2.5 NC balloon. But despite even the this particular manual, that also did not help. Then we at the same time we pre-dilated the left main and. Then this was the shoot after pre-dilatation, both LED as well as left main. And then this is the stent after, once we were unable to cross that long stent, we thought that we should go ahead with the two small stents. So we took 318, considering the small caliber of the LED vessel. And therefore we took 318 stent, endeavor resolute, and we positioned it and inflated. But immediately there was the thing that we noticed that there was no flow after the stent inflation. There was
okay.
The patient started. Hello. Mm. So there was no flow in circ. We actually had put two wires in circ, but because there was this great wire wrapping and which was obstructing our pathway of hardware, so we for time being we removed that wire. But unfortunately, once the stent was inflated, there was no flow in circ. Patient started having angina and hypotension. So immediately we used whisper wire and we crossed the stent stress and the parking distal circ. Then we pre-dilated the circ lesion with 210 balloon. And once we pre-dilated that, immediately the circ flow was restored. Flow was restored. Then after this, we took. We noticed that there was a lesion in LED, and there was dissection. The haziness observed at the distal stent edge. So we thought that we should first fix that, and we took 2.514 because the distal LED diameter was quite small. So we took 2.514, and we overlapped the proximal left main stent with posterior LED stent. We inflated that, and after this. I could not save we took the shoot, but we could not save that shoot after deploying the second stent. Now this is the second stent. We put the stent balloon in the left main and then stent in the ostial circ, where we kept 2 to 3 struts in the left main and ensured with the balloon that we are not encroaching into left main too much. After this, we inflated the stent. The same balloon and another NC balloon in the LED, we did kissing. After this, we removed both the balloons and then we took two NC balloons. This is the first part that we did, and we inflated the left main stent just proximal to the bifurcation. After this, we took 2.58 another stent balloon. We post dilated the LED lesion. Then we with 2.58 and 310 in LED and 2.58 in SIR. We initially thought that probably the stent in the ostial SIR was not inflated, so we again went at a higher pressure. And this was the final result, sir. This was the final part which we did, and flaring of the ostial left main stent was done. These are the final shoots.
What size balloon did you use in the left main?
Sir, we use 4 balloons, sir, for pot and post dilatation.
Shantanu, I feel initially also left main should have been, should have taken a bigger stent. You took 318 for left main.
Sir, there actually, if you see the caliber of LED, we actually stented it from ostial left main to LED, and LED caliber was hardly 275. So we thought that we will go with the 3O balloon and then we will post dilate with the 4O balloon. So we will inflate the, we'll do part of left main with 4O balloon to maximize stent diameter.
I still feel LED won't be so small, they are already, they are usually underfilled. So, Sir Bansal, sir, what do you think?
No, I still feel that all the stents are little undersized.
Yes.
And just having a you have already taken 2.5 and you have taken 3. So the left main should have been at least 4.5 millimeters.
Exactly.
And the Santosh should have been larger so that you get a better long-term results.
Yes.
Immediately he has been stabilized, we agree.
Yes. Actually, sir, the age of the patient, his all comorbid conditions, we are a little skeptical about whether he will tolerate, whether he will sustain with such a 3.5 or 4 stain. So that's why we thought that to avoid the catastrophe, better
Santosh,
to go.
Just wanted to comment one thing. When we do bifurcations now, we are, usually, initially we are scared to take a bigger size, but left main, LED, circosteal are very big vessels. They will definitely take, even 3.5 is not a big deal. They could have easily taken. Sir, Bhagwat sir, what do you say? Sir, you have to unmute yourself, sir.
Yeah, can you hear me now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so I have a few comments. First of all, when you started, you had a plan of two stent strategy or a provisional strategy? That is number one.
Yeah, sir, we had plan of two stents, sir.
Okay, then in that case, you had a two stent strategy with a plan of doing a tap, or
yes,
exactly. So that was your plan.
So we had a plan of mini crush, sir. We actually planned for mini crush. We are comfortable with mini crush, but seeing the very tight nature of the left main as well as which was very diffuse disease right from the ostium, we thought that putting two stents in left main with ostial circ and ostial LED, so patient there would be the ischemia because of already tight left main, and if we obstruct the blood flow with two stents over there, patient may not tolerate that, and he would crash on table with that. So with that fear in mind, we thought that just first fix the left main and LED, and once we are done with that, then we'll see for the options.
I have one suggestion that if you have a two stent strategy, you should have a two stent strategy in such lesions, because it was 1-1-1 with kind of ostial plaque. So it's always better to have two stent strategy here, and if you do that, it is better to choose either a mini crush or a DK crush rather than choosing a tap in such situation, because you had a problem because your circ closed, and yes, then sir. Sometimes what happens is if the patient becomes unstable, his EF was 30%. In such patients become unstable with this plan, sometimes you can get into trouble. Then second thing was you should have better bed preparation.
Yes.
No, bed preparation was a problem in your case. You should have dilated with bigger balloons, used bigger stents as has been said by other experts, because then you had initially problem in putting your stent in the LED. So it's always better to prepare the bed properly in these patients, and never never ever use a 2.5 or not even 2.75 in proximal LED. Even we used to do it long ago, but we've stopped doing it. Particularly in this situation, use, at least if you want to go across from left main to LED, you can easily go with a 3.5 stent. The LED will take it in this situation, because a endeavor resolute to go from 3 to 4, may be difficult. A latest stent, like for example, Onyx or Synergy can go, easily up by one, but resolute, I'm not too sure. So these are a few comments which I had to make.
Santosh, one more advice, just a suggestion, like a friend, as a friend, that try using cutting balloons. They are very helpful for left main and bifurcations, and never be in a hurry to put a stent initially, very fast. Even if the patient is having a low hemodynamics, try to balloon dilate it, unless you have a thrombus burden. I don't think that he had an acute coronary.
He had acute coronary, sir. In Tropa,
he was a failure. No, you said he was in failure.
Failure, but Tropa was way high elevated, sir. It was
okay. Because seeing the anatomy, they were like old fibrotic disease more than acute coronary.
So you have to be very patient, and sometimes in initial phases we are in a hurry to put in a stent. We want to just stent it and finish it off. But to in left main to have best bed preparation is the key to success.
Yes, I agree that in case you are going to have an imaging, then the correct size. But when you are not going to do the imaging, a good bed preparation is very important, and that too in a 75-year-old man. Chances of some calcium is bound to be there. Yes, so a good pre-dilatation.
But Dr. Bansal. Yes. Dr. Bansal, I think we did see a speck of calcium in the distal lip.
Yes.
In the osteolar lid in an eccentric manner. So I think a Flextorm would have been a much better option. 3 Flextorm there would have prepared the bed fantastically and will allowed a long stent also to cross. And second thing, the plaque shift with sequential dilatations with 2.5, one in the left main, one in the LAD, that might have also responsible for the closure of the circumflex. What do you think, Ajit? If you have used a Flextorm, probably the plaque shift may not have occurred that much, you know?
See, it was an acute coronary syndrome, so it could have been some thrombus shift or some plaque shift. I agree with you. I mean, but in this situation, I think bed preparation was the key. And you should, you can take maybe 15 minutes more.
Yes.
But if you use bigger balloons, the subsequent procedure becomes very smooth and clean.
One more point that don't think that stent is going to expand the lesion, right? Stent is only to scaffold the lesions. You have to prepare the bed nicely with NC balloons, OPN balloon, or cutting balloon, whatever the cost permits.
Right. Sir. Right, sir. Actually, my only concern was if I pre-dilated frequently or with a larger balloon, the considering its ACS lesion, whether there will be new thrombus formation and whether there will be new flow phenomenon, especially in case of left main and LAD. So I thought. It would be difficult once such complication happens after and once the patient start deteriorating with this severe LAD.
Santosh, you got away with acute result, but long term, I don't think you will have a very good result long term wise, because stents are literally under deployed. Means it is, we all are learning, so it's nothing to feel like you did something wrong. Everybody does the same, but. Take home message is that bed preparation and adequate sizing. They are definitely undersized.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, Santosh. Anybody else, sir? Anybody wants to comment? Okay.
What's the next case?
Okay. Then we'll go to the next presenter, and probably Dr. Anuj is around. No. Then we move to Dr. Sudhir Shetkar. He is going to talk about dedicated bifurcation stenting step crush techniques. So over to Dr. Sudhir.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you for this. This first case was also good, but good acute result, definitely long-term results in such a situation. I think the acute results were very good. My case is a simple case. I'm going to share the screen. So this is the case of a step crush technique. First of all, I don't have anything to disclose. And in a brief, the clinical profile of the patient, this is a 70-year-old male patient, non-diabetic, non-hypertensive, and presented with recent onset class 3 angina on exertion. His LV was normal, and we did his angiography through the right radial approach. We showed a LAD proximal 99% critical lesion with a diagonal 1 ostial 99% lesion. Circumflex and RSCA were having minor plaques. So this is the angiogram. You can see the proximal LAD is having a critical lesion. And this is the cranial view. Again, the diagonal is pretty big. It's a good caliber as well as a long vessel. It's almost supplying a large part of the lateral wall. The RCA was having mild mid disease and nothing significant. Now, we all know the Medina classification. This was fitting in the 101 classification. And when we go for deciding between the provisional and bifurcation stenting, definitely the size of the side branch is something which we look for. This was a big vessel, almost to more than 2.5 millimeter size. And the disease at the ostium was also very significant, which could have led to plaque shift and abrupt closure of the side branch. Hence, we decided in the beginning with a two stent strategy. We chose a speck crush technique because the patient was very thin build, and we had taken the radial approach, and we needed a low profile guiding catheter. And step crush is ideally suitable for these things. because both the stents are taken stepwise, man. We're not taking both the stents together. Hence, a low profile guide can also do in these cases. So we took a 6-French guiding catheter, and it's an ideal for radial intervention and gives a good ostial coverage of the side branch.
Just to interrupt, just a thought. It was a ad hoc plasty, or you had planned it before?
It was planned. Angio was planned before, but it was done immediately post angio.
Then why didn't you take 7 French? Because 6 French do have some problems with the 2 balloons sometimes.
We had taken the radial approach, and the patient was a thin built patient, so we thought rather than shifting to the femoral approach, we'll go ahead with the 6 French and we'll take the step crush technique.
Okay, go ahead.
Initially, we had decided to go for mini crush, but when we were negotiating both the stents together, they were not crossing. We switched over to a step crush technique. So first, we wired both the branches. We took a BMW and All-Star wire for the diagonal. And after wiring, we first pre-dilated both the proximal LED lesion as well as the ostium of the diagonal. We did not did a kissing balloon here because there was no significant disease at the bifurcation in the main vessel. First, the side branch stent was taken. Along with the main branch, there was a balloon to crush the stent, and we first deployed the side branch stent. It was 2.5 into 18 drug eluting stent. And after deploying the side branch stent, we crushed the side branch stent with the balloon in the left main vessel, which is 2.5 into 15 balloon. Now, this is a very critical step because we have to remove the side branch balloon and wire without fail. Otherwise, we'll risk trapping the balloon. So this is a very critical step, and we should always remove. After that, we took a 3x33 drug eluting stent in the main vessel, the LED, and deployed it. Then the main vessel, main branch stent pot was done with a 3.5 into 15 NC balloon. This is also a very important step, which is missed many of the times. Pot is necessary because while recrossing the side branch, if pot is not done, then we might end up passing through the stent strut. So this step is very important, and pot of the main branch stent must be done. And then we recrossed the side branch stent and took 2 balloons for the final kissing. Final kissing was done with a 2.5 to 8 NC balloon in the diagonal and 3.5 to 15 NC in the LED. And again, after that, this is also second pot. The final pot of the main vessel main branch stent was done. Because again, the same issue, while recrossing, we might have damaged the initial struts. So to make sure that they are well opposed, we do a final part of the main branch stent. And finally, this is the result we could get. So side branch and main branch angulation is very step while deciding for the technique. If it is more than 70 degrees, we could have easily gone with a tap. But since it was very acute angulated, we decided to go with a crush. Mini crush was not possible because of the reason we had taken a small guide, so 2 stents were not easily negotiable. And since there was a significant size disparity between the main branch and the side branch, we could not go with the pilot technique also. And since low profile guide was used, this was the ideal approach. We thought that we can do it. Thank you.
Thank you, Sudhir. Nicely done. Now I have one or two small questions. One is, I'd like to ask the panel, our chairperson, sir, what do you suggest that we have opted for, because it's not an acute thing, should have been opted for DK crush? And second is about the pot. Should we have taken a NC balloon or a semi-compliant balloon for pot? I want a suggestion, sir.
See, basically, if you look at the angle, I think his choice was all right. You know, it was about, I would say, 45 degrees. What do you think? About 45. So, you know, DK crush is an acceptable technique in this situation. Second point which I wanted to make was, when you crush, the only difference between your technique and mini crush is you are crushing with the balloon first. With mini crush, you will have stand there and crush directly. But you have to remember that regardless of whether you use step technique or DK crush, there is always a 5% chance that you will not be able to enter the side branch again.
Exactly.
So this is experienced by even the expert operators. So in difficult situations, you must have guide wires like Fielder XT or some
hydrophilic
guide wires with very very small tip. So sometimes it can be very difficult because you are crossing 3 layers of the stent. two in the side branch ostium and one of the main branch stent. The third point which I want to make is when you crush these stents, you know, always crush with a generous size balloon. Don't crush with 2.5. Sometimes, you know, it gives you a false impression that you have crushed it. Maybe Dr. Sachin Mukherjee has that case, so he will show that point that, you know, if you crush it with a small balloon, you will sometimes find difficult to put the stent in. So crush it with a bigger balloon. You may be a little afraid of producing a dissection. But even if you produce a dissection, small dissection there, it's not going to harm because you're going to stent the main vessel anyway. So, those are the few techniques. And the other technical points and the other question which was asked about POT. So POT is not only for bridging the gap between the vessel wall and the stent, main vessel stent. It also helps you in opening the, pushing the struts, the distal struts, into the side branch and making the side branch entry easy. So that's very important point. And I think, using proximally, your question was whether you should use a compliant balloon or non-compliant balloon. Generally for POT, I go with a non-compliant balloon. You put the main branch stent should always be put based on the distal vessel size. Okay. And then you dilate the proximal part of the main branch with a appropriate height, larger and use a non-compliant balloon. Those are the few points which I wanted to make.
Bansal, sir, comment, sir.
No, I think with the radial catheter, the job done is satisfactory. There is nothing to dispute about it. And Bhagwat has already made the point that you should make it roomy adequately proximally, so that you ensure that the crush is adequate. Because, you know, since in India, the application of imaging is far less. Most of our cases are without the imaging. So you will not know the status of the stent layers. So therefore, using a good size balloon to crush is a very important step, because that will help you your next stent to be fitted very well. And you should always, one enemy of your complications is low volume. When the room is less, immediate complications, long-term complications are going to be more. So our hypothesis stands, larger the better, roomier the better. So that is the only thing I would wish to say. Otherwise, a well-done case. And I suppose he has used two low-profile stents because they have gone through a 6 French guiding catheter. You very rightly in the beginning only said, since it was a planned patient, a 7 French in a bifurcation is always the preferred choice.
Want to say, Jairam? Yeah, Sudhir, you want to say? Yes.
I want to ask from the expert, when we are recrossing the side branch after deploying the main vessel stent, should we use the wire in the main vessel to cross so that we can cross to the distalmost strut?
Yeah, you can always, that's the easiest way to do it, provided you have given it a proper curve. You know, initially when you're going in, what happens is sometimes you don't give it a curve when you enter the left main. And when you want to do it while you are pulling it out, you need some bend there when you want to go in the side branch. So make sure that you give that bend right at the beginning. That is one. You can use the main branch stent or going inside through the distal strut. One important point I would like to mention that we have started doing recently is, if you want to reduce your time for crossing again into the side branch, what you do is before putting your main branch stent, you just dilate the side branch stent ostium with a 2 mm balloon, like you do in DK crush. You don't have to do DK crush, but just to facilitate your entry into the side branch after putting the main branch stent. If you have dilated the side branch ostium before, it becomes a little easy. That, you know.
But that will take another recross. It will be extra recross.
Yes. Extra balloon, you mean?
No, we have to recross again. And then
yes, you have to recross again. When doesn't, that is easier. That's quite easy, you know, to cross that crush stent is much easier than crossing 3 layers of the stent. So if you just, you know, it saves time. Dr. Sameen Sharma, in one of his recent workshops, had mentioned this point that they do mini crush with this technique. It saves time.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Sudhir. Thank you for a nice presentation. Now we'll move on. We'll have Dr. Sachin is around. Sachin is there? Dr. Sachin?
Dr. Sachin Mukhedkar, I can see his name.
Okay. Then I'll introduce Dr. Sachin to present his case. He's going to talk about bifurcation, trifurcation, stenting, and welcome Dr. Sachin. Just you can take over now and just present your case.
Sachin, can you hear us? Sachin is not able to hear us. Looks like.
Dr. Shantanu, Sachin, can you hear us? Yes, sir.
Yes, yes, I can hear.
Then share your screen.
Yes. Good evening, everybody. Today's case point I want to make in this discussion is regarding the LAD D1 bifurcation stenting by DK crush technique. The message I want to give is that we should crush the side branch stent with an appropriate size or a larger size balloon so that the case goes smoothly and will not get stuck while we are going stepwise in doing DK crush. So this was a 59 years old female. She was diabetic. She presented to us with recent onset rest angina. She underwent PTCA with stent to posterior descending artery.
We're not able to see the slides. Slides are not moving.
Dr. Sachin,
we can't hear you.
Dr. Sachin, you're on mute.
Yes.
You are on mute, I suppose.
Sachin, are you on mute?
No, sir. There was some issue with
internet.
So you can go ahead and share your screen again.
Share your screen. I think there is some problem with his internet connection.
Right, I think so too, sir. Support team, could you please connect with Dr. Sachin Mukhedkar?
Chantru, can we play slides from here?
Sir, I don't have access to his presentation.
Okay.
I will get the support team to resolve the issue with Dr. Sachin and we can move ahead to Dr. Rahul.
Fine.
Yeah.
Fair enough. So, Dr. Rahul Singla, I'll invite you now to present a case on bifurcation, trifurcation, stenting. And over to you, Rahul. Please go on.
Good evening, sir. Can you hear me, sir?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, we can.
Yes. Good evening, distinguished faculty. I would like to present three cases on bifurcation. I will go through them very quickly. Case number one, he was a 47-year-old male, diabetic hypertensive tobacco chewer, presented to us with anterior wall MI of 1 day back. He was thrombolyzed outside and was transferred to JJ Hospital for CAG and SOS PTCA. His echo was about 35% ejection fraction and with anterior wall hypokinesia. This is his angiography in which the left side was done, it was done with radial by a femoral route with 6F JL catheter. Left side showed LAD and RAMS, both ostium are diseased, which we can see in the ileocaudal view clearly. And also the right hand side, right coronary had 70% lesion in distal part. The lesion was Medina 011. So we opted for V type of technique and we used 7F EBU guide from right femoral route. These are the guide shoots. both the LED and REMUS were wired with filter FC wire, and drug eluting stent of 2.75 into 18 in LED and 2.75 into 15 in REMUS were used. Position was checked and were deployed for deployed simultaneously at 12 to 14 atmosphere simultaneously.
Rahul, just hold on. Yes,
I'll go.
Sir, Bansal sir and Bhagav sir, position is appropriate for V-stenting this?
Well, actually, if it was true V, I would have pulled them back a little bit.
Exactly.
LED stent was deliberately a little bit pulled back, sir, as we can see in this way, sir.
No, that will crush the stent then.
Or you wanted to do kind of a tap kind of a thing? Or T-stent?
Kind of, sir, SKS technique, sir, in this.
This is not SKS. This is not even V.
Yeah.
You know, you have to pull it slightly.
The stent is not protruding. The MS1 is not protruding into the main branch.
Right. Okay, go ahead.
Yes. And sir, this was the result after deployment of the stent, and this is the final result.
Sir, do you also feel that ostium is missed of the MS?
See, with this position, I would be little scared about the, you know, missing the ostium of the diagonal or ramus, whatever it is.
Yes.
If you know, if you want to be 100% sure that you are covering the ostium, you can either do a proper V by pulling that stent back, or do a SKS or whatever you call
sir,
it.
Sir, otherwise provisional stenting would have been an okay approach, isn't it? Don't you
or
feel?
Or provisional stenting, or just choose a dedicated two stent crush technique.
Right
at the beginning,
because nowadays we is not preferred a thing to do, isn't it, sir?
Yeah, because the data is not sufficient.
Now if there is a wrist stenosis, very difficult to cross, isn't it?
Right. So I mean, if something goes wrong in the future, then you're kind of stuck.
Rahul, it is very easy to do it, but you know, you have to learn something difficult also.
Yes.
Okay, good. Go ahead.
RCA was done with, sir, 3.518 regulating stent, and this was the end result. Now, going on to next case, sir. He was a
anybody want to comment on this case? Anybody else?
Rahul, actually, I want to share my opinion on this.
Yes,
I would say that when you are taking two stents together, you yes. should make sure in this particular situation, probably it would have been better, probably Dr. Bhagwat and Bansal sir and Gaurav will also agree with me, that you need to be very, very cautious of keeping both the markers on top of each other. That is a key actually.
Yes, sir.
I mean, when you saw that each one started talking that your stent placement is probably not perfect. If you wanted to make a proper V or you want to make something like SKS, so SKS, yes. Even Dr. Sameer Sharma has left doing SKS nowadays. So, what I would suggest that probably if you have kept both the markers on each other, and another yes. thing which is important, then when you know that where your stent starts after the marker, that is very, very crucial. Whenever you are doing a bifurcation, you need to know that each of your stent, I mean, every stent is not same. Some stent is slightly different. Some stent actually starts immediately after the marker. Some stent actually start half the marker, and some stents, they have full marker involved. So you need to be know this thing very, very carefully.
Okay.
Please go with your next presentation.
Sir, my second case is 36-year-old male who was smoker, presented to us with chest pain from one day, and his enzymes were positive. He had history of interwall MI 2 months back, where he was done with PTCA to LED in some other private hospital, but details of the same were not available. On echo, he had interwall hypokinesia with LVF 30%. So this was his angiogram. It was done through right femoral root. And what we can see was that LED stent was there, but it had TIMI-2 flow, and ostium there being 60 to 70% in L6 ostium. So in this case, offered imaging, but he could not afford the same. So in view of his enzyme being positive with ECG changes, we plan to go ahead with PTCA to LCX. we planned sort of T technique in which LED stent, which was deployed 2 months earlier, will act as a side branch stent, and wire was passed in both LED and LCX, and the lesion was in LCX was stented like LM to LCX with 3.5 into 13 mm drug-eluting stent, and this was followed by NC balloon dilatation with 3.5 into 8 mm in LCX portion. This was followed by POT to LM part with the same balloon at high pressure, 16 to 18 ATM. Recrossing in LED was done, and the struts of the stent across the LED was opened with 2 into 8 mm balloons. After this, kissing was carried out with 3.5 mm balloon, 3.5 into 8 mm balloon in LCX and 3.5 into 13 in LED at 12 to 14 atmosphere each simultaneously. After this, a report was done with 4.5 into 8 mm NC balloon in LM portion over the LM-LED wire, and this was the final result.
Rahul, just a small comment that why didn't you take a bigger stent to circumflex to cover, because the balloon, the pot which what you are doing is into the non-stented segment as well, because we don't have a smaller balloons now, and you must be knowing that we have to do a pot.
Sir, the pot was done with 8 mm balloon in the over the LED side, and we
did you not stent from the left main ostium into the circ?
Yes, sir.
So no, show me your stented shoot, that stent placement.
Yes, I'll just
You missed the ostium here.
Yes, sir. I have not inflated the balloon in the ostium. The
only issue is that, if you do micro dissections during POT, it doesn't give a long-term good results. So always, it doesn't matter if you take a 2-4 millimeter bigger stent. Bhagwat sir, what do you say?
Yeah, true. I mean, it's always in such a situation, there is no point in leaving 1-2 millimeters of left main ostium, because if you dissect, sometimes it can extend into aorta. So the best thing is to stent right from the ostium and go into the LED or circumflex, whatever. Yeah.
And other thing is, sorry,
yeah,
anybody?
Yeah. Bhagwat sir, I just wanted to add this thing. I agree with this, left main ostium should have been covered. And Rahul, probably the view which you haven't taken, I mean, whenever you are doing a bifurcation, LO caudal and AP caudal, these are the best views in which we work. And just to make sure your ostium of the left main is covered or not, you should go to allocranial. It will give you a clear-cut idea that your stent is actually approached up to the left main ostium, or you are slightly out of it. I mean, just to make sure that ostium is covered, you should take that allocranial view also.
Just one question.
Yeah, Dr. Verma, sorry, you are saying something.
Somebody's saying.
Yeah, I was saying. There is some haziness in the ostium of the LED. Was the stent in the LED exactly from the ostium? Because I think that it might have missed the ostium in the first place, because there is some haziness at the ostium of the LED also. Might be that is the reason for slow flow.
No, sir. We thought that the stent was bang into the ostium. That is why we did the pot over there.
Maybe there is a small branch arising. I mean, there is a very small branch which is arising there. That may be the cause which probably Sudhir is taking as a dissection.
The branch is coming right at the bifurcation.
Yeah. At the ramus position, you can see a tiny branch. If you see the first frame, can you see this? A very tiny branch which is arising just at the ramus position. So it may be giving an impression of dissection. The patient is okay after this, Rahul?
Patient is okay, probably.
It's not
dissection. He's okay, sir.
Okay, Rahul, go ahead.
Yes, sir. That is all, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. So, any comments? Ponde sir is around? Sahu sir?
Yeah.
Sir, your comments, please.
Yes, I think the stent should have been maybe 3.5-18 to cover the left main completely. And that haziness Sudhir is saying, I think that is the small tweak which was lost after the stenting. Yeah.
Okay.
you hear? It was 3.5 13 stent, and smaller stent you have for what is 8 millimeter. So maybe that is not sufficient. So the central length should have been slightly more.
Okay, sir.
Pandey sir, yes, sir.
Yeah, I think I agree with Rahul that the left main, the LAD ostium near the carina of the left main towards the circumflex, there is a haziness which I would not like to see at the end of the procedure. You know, it will give me a sleepless night, I think. As Rahul was saying, can you see the first frame? Was there a branch arising as he was saying?
Right. I'll show it. I'll show the angiogram, sir.
Show the last shoot.
Yes, sir. Last shoot.
After kissing, yeah.
Yes, sir. This is the last shoot, sir.
Yeah, it's a small, tiny branch which is arising.
Actually, you need to reconfirm by taking other shoots which are not shown here. I'm sure he has taken more pictures, but he has selected only one iliocaudal.
Yeah, Bansal sir, I think in the angiogram we have iliocaudal view also. Can you go for the angio frame?
Angiographic iliocaudal.
The last shoot of angio is iliocaudal.
Can you
show this third one?
It needs to be enlarged.
What I meant is in the final shoots, there are multiple projections that are taken.
Yeah.
But it would be showing only one of them.
And there is something there.
Yeah, it's almost similar picture. I would say that it is. Irregularity at the ramus position. Probably it's a branch which is...
Maybe, sir, it was a ACS, no? There may be some thrombus at that moment. Because he had dropped.
Probably it was positive.
Dr. Gauro.
Yes.
Hello.
Gauro, yes, sir. Sir.
You would have resorted probably at the end of when you are doing left main to circumflex and you are having such a thing which is not very sure. I think the comfortable position would be to image this. Don't you think so? What does Dr. Bansal and Dr. Ajit feel?
No, imaging is ideal. No, doing any left main imaging is ideal.
Imaging is ideal, and wherever possible, the imaging should always be done. But you know, you have a lot of issues of cost constraints, availability at your center. Yes. Therefore, a lot of our people are doing without imaging.
Correct.
Otherwise,
imaging
is ideal for this location.
Correct.
Sir, suppose we find that haziness is there. So, what else can we have done? You know, we have just waited or we have repeated angio after a week or some other option.
See, since it was there in the first film also.
Yes, sir, it was there.
We do not know what exactly it was.
Yeah.
It continues sir, the same. So sometimes wait and watch and observe the patient also helps.
Gaurav, why I was saying, just sorry to interrupt, why I was saying this LAD stent was implanted 2 months ago, right?
Yes, sir.
And
yes, sir.
To make it sure that stent has covered the LAD ostium properly, I think the imaging right at the outset would have given much, much better level of confidence, number one. Number two, when you are putting a stent from left main to circumflex in this scenario where the LAD stent may or may not have been at the ostium, you are producing a carinal deformation.
Exactly.
And that deformation at the end of a true ostial LAD restenosis, which will be almost impossible to handle with intervention later on. What does Ajit think about this? What does Dr. Bansal think about this?
Yeah, as I said, imaging in this situation is
ideal.
Kind of mandatory these days. But Dr. Bansal has already mentioned that it is not possible to do it all the time in a government hospital setup. But you are right. I mean, we really don't know what is the situation in the LAD ostium, whether there is metal there is no metal. If it just remains a stent-free area between two stents, You know, what is the implication of that? If it develops restenosis there, how will you treat it? Those are definitely some issues. But suppose, Dr. Ponde, suppose we would have done imaging, and if we see that the proximal 3 millimeters or 2 millimeters of LAD do not have a stent, what would be the approach in that situation? Would you do anything different?
Yeah, we would probably resort to treating the LAD as a vessel, which is a major side branch with a major side branch. And secondly, at the end of the procedure, this haziness which is there, then it creates a panic situation. Let me tell you, you have to take as I can say, you have to say provisional stenting and good TIMI 3 flow, no angina, you would leave it alone. That's fine, but I would still for imaging.
Sir, how did this patient do? He did well?
Yes, sir. This patient did well, sir. He is in follow-up, sir. He reported to us after 1.5 months of his stenting. He was seen in June. Not reported to us back to us. It is good.
In hindsight, your judgment was all right.
Okay. Sir, a question for sir chairperson. Suppose 2 millimeter are missed. So, do we from the initial go, we will have a two-stent strategy for a bifurcation, or we'll do a provisional?
To be honest, I would not, if the LAD ostium looks very clean, and if you have imaging, then you will have, proper imaging and document it's clean, and then you can go ahead with the same strategy which you have used now.
But see, after imaging, the LAD ostium looks clean, the matter is different, but here the LAD ostium is not looking the...
Suppose imaging shows that 2 millimeter is missed, then what will be our approach?
It's clean.
That's what I'm saying, that if it is clean,
right?
Yes.
Then we can do the clean. Then I think whatever you have done
is okay. All right. And sir, you recommend?
Gaurav, I want to ask you, for my learning, I want to ask you people. Sometimes the way here left main is there, we were telling him not to leave the left main ostium alone. But look, the ostium funnels out quite well. The ostial left main diameter is far too bigger than that. So in such a situation, ending subostially, is it any no game, Dr. Ajit Bansal?
There is no problem in stenting at this point, leaving the ostium. But then the only problem occurs when you have to do a pot. Then when you do a pot, you don't have that short a balloon. The shortest balloon you have is 8. And then you probably go beyond the crina for doing this pot.
Sir, suppose it has been a longish left main. Definitely, we would love to end it there only, but with a gap of 8 millimeter to do a pot nicely. That is a concern.
I think Dr. Ponde's point is very important, that funnel is quite big, and that artery at the ostium may be, at least a millimeter bigger than your shaft of the left main.
So how will you?
Address that. I think the best option to do it is use a bigger balloon. Imaging is the best in this situation, but if you don't have it, stent it from the ostium and use a generous balloon to post dilate. I think that's
Ponde sir, I want to add one thing. I worked with Sameer Sharma sir also, and so what we have learned that if you have a 6 millimeter length balloon, that is the best. I mean, if you have 3.56 or 4.6 or 4.56, that is the best balloon. So whenever you are doing this type of a short left main or a moderate size left main, then you should make sure that you have 6 millimeter balloon on your shelf. And if it is there, then probably you can leave the stent wherever you want. I mean, if you see that rest of the left main is healthy, then probably you can start in the shaft of the left main also. But if you are in doubt, or if you don't have 4.6 balloon, then I would suggest that you should cover whole of the left main. I mean, there is no idea of leaving 2-3 millimeter of the left main. And while putting the pot, you actually dilate in unstented part, which may be a problem later. This is my suggestion.
Sir, and any suggestion regarding doing a check angio in a week or in a month time? Anybody recommend that? For the LAD probably.
I would only do a check angio if the patient has symptoms.
Okay, sir.
Or the patient is ischemia test driven positive.
Okay.
Otherwise, it may be a good practice to leave the patient alone.
Because
commenting on that left main ostium, that is almost about 5 millimeters, you know.
Yeah, correct. Yeah, exactly. That
problem is,
how will you approximate?
If you bring the stent into the ostium, approximating that will be a big problem. So you might need a 5 or 5.5 balloon to do that complete job. See, look at the reflux. It is almost like a funnel, you know.
True. Right, sir. Okay, Rahul, thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
We'll move further now. We can carry on with Dr. Sachin's presentation. Sachin, you are ready? Hello, Sachin.
Dr. Sachin, can you hear us? I don't think his audio is connected, so we can move on to the next presentation. We will
then Dr. Rahul Gupta will invite you to please present your case for all trifurcations are not the same. Please go ahead, sir.
Yeah, can you hear me, Gaurav?
Yeah,
Dr. Ravi, we can hear you. You can and share your screen, sir.
Yeah. So thanks, Translubina, Bansal sir, Ponde sir, Bhagwat sir, Gaurav. Sachin is here. Sachin, you are you ready? So you want to present? Sachin, Dr. Sachin Mukherjee.
Sachin, no. Unmute yourself.
Unmute.
Dr. Sachin, you're on mute.
Yes.
I can present, but due to heavy rains, there is a lot of fluctuation in the range of the net actually.
I think you should start.
The rains are quite heavy.
No issue. You try. Let us see how much far we can go.
Yes,
try.
I'll start.
Yeah, please.
Thank you, Dr. Ravi.
I will be presenting this case of LAD diagonal bifurcation, which was done by a decay crush technique. The message I want to give is
Dr. Sachin, we can't see your screen.
I think he's getting frozen.
Yes.
There is some
a lot of internet issue.
Yeah.
To heavy rains.
Actually, you can, Dr. Ravi Gupta, you can present your case.
Okay. So what we'll do that if he can manage to join us again, Sachin. So we'll take him up after my case. So what, we'll save time. And I can't share my screen.
Yes, sir. Dr. Sachin is trying to share his screen again.
Yeah.
Sachin, if you could unmute yourself. Dr. Sachin, if you could unmute yourself. Yes.
So this was a case of LAD diagonal bifurcation. So we can see there is an bifurcation stenosis of Medina type 111.
Your slides are not moving. Your slides are not moving. Now it is.
They're moving now, sir.
So we can see there is an bifurcation stenosis of Medina type 111 with an large diagonal. The diagonal is bigger than LAD actually. The angle between the diagonal and LAD is a narrow angle, maybe around 45 to 50 degrees. So with the strategy of putting two stents, we thought of going with a decay crush technique. So both the vessels were wired. The main vessel stenosis was pre-dilated with a 2x12 semi-compliant balloon.
I think it's not moving.
But we can't.
Slides are stuck, I think.
No, now his image is also stuck. Yeah. Dr. Sachin, can you hear us?
Yes, yes, I can hear. I'm very sorry because of the connection issues.
Sachin, we can see you. Go ahead.
Yeah, please, please.
So the main vessel was pre-dilated with a 2x12 semi-compliant balloon. Then we side branch stent was taken. It was a 2.5x12 Ultimaster stent, and side branch stent was placed with 2 to 3 millimeters protrusion in the main vessel. So the side branch stent, after putting the side branch stent, the side branch stent was crushed with a balloon of 2.5x12 in the main vessel. So this was the injection after the side branch stenting. The wires were crossed. So LED wire was crossed over to diagonal, and diagonal wire was crossed over in the LED. So the side branch was, after recrossing it, it was pre-dilated with a smaller size balloon, 2 mm balloon. So so after recrossing both the wires, side branch and main vessel, there was the first kiss that was performed. After doing the first kiss, this was the result.
What was the balloon in the LED for the kissing?
Balloon in the LED was 2.75 by 10.
Can you show the film again? That kissing. Can you run the kissing this thing film?
2.75 by 10.
Can you show the kissing run again?
Yes, yes. Once.
One run back. Yes.
This was the first case.
And looks very small LED balloon, isn't it? Sir Bhagwat sir, Bansal sir, what do you feel?
Yeah, it is small, but the thing is, this is the first kiss before putting in a stent. And I don't, what was the size you said, Sachin?
2.75 is saying.
2.75 for the crush. Yeah, I mean, if it is 2.75, you know, it's fairly fairly big. Anyway.
Sir, what size should we take for the kiss?
See, ideally, when you are crushing, I have realized that it should be the stent, the size of the balloon which you use for crushing should be at least 2.75. I don't think it was 2.75. It must have been 2.5.
Yeah, that is what I was thinking.
Just, you know, 2.75 or 3, that's the least diameter you should use for crushing. And what happened was, after this first kiss, when we tried to, you know, pass the stent, it would get stuck at that point.
Right, sir. So these are all learning points, isn't it?
See this.
So after multiple attempts, we could not cross with the stent. So stent was taken out. Then we tried to pass a 2.75 NC balloon, but that too, it was very means difficult to pass the balloon on a single wire. At last, we have to take a buddy wire. As you can see, there are two wires. So with the buddy wire, we were able to pass a 2.75 by 12 sprinter NC balloon, and after that the side by stent was properly crushed. So this is the crush actually.
Now it looks nice.
Can I make a comment?
Yes, yes. Go ahead, sir.
See, when you have done some optimal crush of the side branch stent in this technique, if you are,
yes,
as Dr. Ajit said very correctly, you have taken an undersized balloon to crush. Therefore, some of the struts may be still protruding in the main branch. That is why you couldn't cross the balloon. In this scenario, to take a buddy wire, there is a huge issue. Sometimes the buddy wire can cross through one of the unopened, uncrushed truss of the side branch stent. And then when you try to crush it again, it gets completely gelled into there and will be impossible to retrieve or remove.
So whenever
this has happened once long back.
Yeah, it can happen. So you have to be when you are recrossing that area, you have to be very gentle.
Very gentle, yeah. And all the time, the tip of the wire should be towards the opposite side of the side branch when you are going through as a buddy into the main branch. The tip of the wire should be always directed on the opposite side of the main side branch. Otherwise, you might just cross over.
Yes, sir. That care we have to take. But it was a desperate call actually, because we had no choice to do it, because apart from using a guideliner or a buddy wire, there was no means choice for us to go ahead in the case.
Have you ever used double lumen microcatheter?
Double lumen micro? No, sir. I have not ever used it.
Ajit, have you used double lumen microcatheter?
Maybe.
Ajit? Bansal, sir?
Used, but I have seen it being used in our laboratory by so one of the visitors.
Will come as a boon, you know, because... Yeah.
It's a boon. See, yeah, we had a Japanese visitor who had bought a bag full of material, and he was using these double lumen microcatheters frequently.
It is available. It is available now by the name of Crusade.
Now it is available.
Crusade.
So,
the Bhagwati, you are on mute.
Final piece. And
can you hear me now?
Yes, sir, we can hear you now.
So the point here is, we had a wire in the main branch. Okay, so the stent was not going, the balloon was not going. In a desperate situation, what you can do is use the balloon which goes there. Try to dilate serially, sequentially, slowly. Eventually, you will crush the stent. I mean, it's not something which is extremely It's not a dire situation in any way, but at the same time, you want to restrict the use of your hardware and try to finish the procedure in minimum number of balloons as possible. So that's the issue. The best chance for dilating and crushing it is the first chance. So use a proper size balloon and crush it. That's the point.
Yes, sir. That is the point. This was the final case, and this was the final result. Somehow means luckily we could get away with the uncrushed side branch stent and complete the case. So take home message is crush with a larger size balloon, or at least the size of the vessel. Means if the vessel is to vessel or stent for main branch, we are planning 2.75. We should crush the stent with a 2.75 mm balloon at least. That is the message.
I want to add
Thank you, Gaurav,
in this. Yeah, we were talking about the size of the post dilatation balloon for kissing, final kissing. So the dictum, which is usually holds true for almost all the cases, that the sum of the final two balloons should be 2/3 of the sum of the two stents. That is almost always helpful. I mean, for an example, if you have a 4 mm main artery or 2 mm side branch, I'm just giving an example, it becomes 6. So when you take two balloons, you try to select two balloons, the sum of these becomes 2/3 of the sum of the two stents used. I mean, that is a principle you always holds true.
Dr. Ravi, this is what Finet laws says, that, the main branch is around 2/3 of the, size of the sum of the other two.
Yeah.
So thank you, Dr. Sachin and Bhagwat sir, for making us wise in the term that we didn't face the complication ourselves, but we learned that we have to take the sizing appropriately. Sir, one just a comment. Yes. Anybody will suggest a culotte in this, because both the sizes D1 and LED are of the similar size. Mini culotte, I'm asking.
Yeah, you can definitely do a culotte, but my personal philosophy is you should be expert in couple of techniques and keep on using those. That's what we do.
Because angle was not that great for a DK crush, what I felt.
Well, angle was about 40, 45. So, you know, DK crush, it was a good,
Right, sir.
No, can I make a comment?
Yeah, please come. Go on,
yeah, please.
No, see, if you as Dr. Ajit said very clearly, you just keep on practicing at least one good bifurcation technique and go ahead with it. But if you're conversant with all the techniques, then culotte will have, though the angle is not very great for DK, as we all know, long-term results of DK are far better than culotte, number one. Number two, in culotte, after the stenting the main branch, if you are not able to cross through the lowest cell into the side branch, you will have a lot of problems crossing the another stent. You will have a lot of problems.
Sir, then one question arises. I want to just ask. Then that means we all know that DK crush is the best. So while choosing a strategy, what do you feel should be the best strategy? Is it the angle which matters, or what do you know the best? Or the DK crush? All the results, all the things.
Angle is apart. Definitely an important factor.
Yeah.
Angle is definitely an important factor, because can I talk?
Yes, Sachin, go on.
Angle is definitely an important factor. Because for a 90 degree angle or more than 90 degree angle, definitely the side branch, protrusion of the side branch struts into the main vessels is likely to be minimal. That's why we go ahead with K-tap or tap type of techniques. Yeah. Whereas for a narrow angle, the protrusion into the main vessel of the side branch stent is likely to be more. So you are likely to have more metal in the main vessel.
No, Sachin, just hold on. Tab, yes. And
that is what my concepts are. So
Sachin, for yes. Tab or T is not a two stent strategy. That is a provisional stenting. And for this kind, when we have already opted for two stent, my question is that does angle matters in choosing culotte versus DK crush, or the opinion will be like we should use DK crush as a preferential strategy and we should learn and practice that?
That is important. Angle doesn't matter. Okay. See, basically for culotte, the size of the vessels is important. The size of, if the size of the vessels to branch and the main branch is comparable. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Go ahead, sir.
So in that case, you can certainly choose culotte. But I mean, you will hardly have a case where you can do a culotte, but you cannot do a DK crush. I really don't think you will have that situation ever, isn't it?
Yeah.
Sir, so can we, give a message that we should always practice a DK crush, is it?
No, practice one technique and be expert in it.
So that is what we are beginners, no? So you tell us, should we try to do...
For me, I think DK crush is a much much more time-tested technique.
Yeah, trials have shown that, you know.
Right. So even in clinical trials, it has been shown to be better than other techniques like culotte or.
My
say about this is we do bifurcation stent once average for once in a month actually. So initially, like 4-5 years back, the problem was whenever we used to do DK crush or tap or culotte, we used to forget one or two steps out of that particular one technique also. So if we want to get perfect, like we want to get the case to be done smoothly and in an expertized manner, we should be focusing on a single technique so that we will not miss any steps, which is important, because otherwise bifurcation will be a complete mess.
Sir, can we take two questions? There are two questions from the audience, sir. Can we take?
Yeah.
Why not?
Sir, one question is that, imaging is a must for left main bifurcation. For other bifurcations, how much useful is imaging? If we don't have, so should we do it or not? And other question is that, in which situations DK crushes shouldn't be done? Is there any condition?
DK crush should not be done. I mean, if the angle is more than say 80, 90, it's horizontally coming vessel. Or if there is calcium at the origin of horizontally coming vessel, it's a complex side branch which is coming, almost perpendicular to the artery. Then I don't think I will be comfortable in doing a DK crush in that situation. That's probably one area where I would probably definitely choose a tap or a T stenting over DK crush. What was the other question?
Other question that imaging is must for left main. Like yeah. We shouldn't, do left main bifurcation usually without imaging. But for LAD D1 or SIRC OM, should we do imaging is a must or we can go ahead without sometime?
Always help you in any case, but for a routine circumflex or LAD diagonal kind of bifurcations, we don't routinely use imaging at all.
Exactly.
If what happens is if you get into trouble for some reason and you want to know what's going on, then imaging will help you. Whether if there is no flow, slow flow, or some dispute between thrombus and dissection, something goes wrong, then imaging helps you. But as an a priori plan, to begin with, I'm not too sure whether I would use. I will not use imaging in a routine run-of-the-mill bifurcation case.
See, actually, imaging is maximum used in Korea and Japan. That to about 70-80%.
Yeah.
If you look at the Western data also, it is not more than 25-30%.
Max, yeah.
And here, they are all reimbursed category of patients. In our setup, we have to think from our perspective. If you are going to do the case under the Mahatma Gandhi Yojana, you get such a limited budget that you cannot add imaging routinely. So unless the patient is ready to shell out the cost of the imaging, even if you want to do it, you are unable to do it. So cost constraint becomes very, very limiting for our setup. And if you see the CSI data of the annual presentations, our number of imaging cases are always less than 10%.
Absolutely, so sir.
I'm sure most of us would want to add imaging even in a routine case unless and until it's a short, discrete type A lesion. It is not an eccentric plaque. It is not a calcified plaque. Then I might say that imaging is not a must. But imaging always definitely makes us wiser. And it is not only to image once, you must do the imaging twice. Because even after putting the stent, you must make sure that what you have done is perfect. Is it well opposed? There is no dissection at the edges. There is no additional thrombus that have come up. You have adequate expansion, opposition. All these things must be assessed. So imaging when available should always be used. There is no two opinions about it. Even in what looks a simple angioplasty, another 10 minutes more and you will be more confident to go back and sleep at home.
Absolutely, sir. I totally agree. Sir, wanted to share that more than 500 doctors are viewing us on this talk. So it's good for us that many people are interested in our talk and discussion. So we are doing quite a good job. Dr. Sudhir, you want to ask something?
Yeah, I want to ask one question regarding the last case. After deploying the sideband stent, when we crushed the sideband stent, why was the wire not removed?
Yes, that was a mistake.
Because
wire should be removed when you are crushing, period. That was a mistake. And generally nothing happens, but sometimes you can damage the wire and kink the wire.
Sir, off late people have started keeping the wire.
The people are still doing it. But if you read the standard instructions in any technique of crushing, everything should be removed before you crush. Because what happens is sometimes because of your balloon, you can damage that wire, kink that wire, and it will be difficult to pull that wire out after crushing.
Sir, what now understanding what people are propagating is that wire act to cross proximal. So ideally, definitely what you say is correct, that it should be removed because you don't want an entrapped wire. Yeah. But nowadays people want it to be like a marker to cross proximal. So, Pandey sir or Bansal sir, want to comment something?
No, I agree with Ajit that, you know, when you are crushing the side branch stent, the side branch wire has to be removed. Because once in a while, if you land up in a stuck wire over there, you will land up in a very messy case. Number one. And number two is that when you are seeing proximal and distal, I think that for that, if you take two images in orthogonal views after putting the side branch stent, before you crush it in the PA cranial and LAO caudal, you will clearly know the proximal end of the carina and the distal end of the carina. So you will have that visual image of it. And at the, you need not keep a wire there for that. I would say by standard instruction is you remove the wire before you crush the stent. Yeah.
Okay, sir. So our message will be that we have to remove the wire before crushing, right?
Yes.
So any other comments? Otherwise, we'll move forward.
Same thing. This Dr. Pandey sir said that some people actually argue that you should keep the wire inside. It helps you in a marker or if you have difficult to entry. In any case, even if you keep the wire inside, you have chances of stuck in the entrapment of that wire between the lumen of the stent and the coronary arteries lumen. Another thing, in any case, you have to recross it. I mean, you need to use another wire. So this wire is not going to help to save the branch. So I agree. I mean, so there is no idea of keeping the wire. Yeah.
This concept that this wire will allow us to recross by giving us this anatomical landmark, it might be okay in provisional stenting. When we are not stented the side branch, we are just stented the main branch. But in this case, the wire will be interpreted two layers of the stents. It is bound to get trapped.
No, absolutely.
No. Sudhir, it is for the proximal crossing. Wire is a marker at the proximal end.
That is true.
So you know where is the proximal end.
No, Dr. Verma, you are not going to keep that wire and jail it between the main branch stent and the vessel wall, right?
I mean, sir, this is one of the, you know, strategies. You know, people, what you say is absolutely correct. We should remove it. But people keep it to cross proximally. This is what some people are doing.
Okay. Well, I don't know.
Right, sir, right. Okay.
I remember a bad experience of almost, I would say, 17, 18 years back when I was in Escorts, Delhi. So one of my senior colleague actually is stuck up with this situation, and very senior person, very good interventionist. Only thing, either you, when you put the side branch wire, I'm keeping the side branch wire and inflating the main vessel stent, then either you should not go to complete full pressure. That is important. Either you go to minimal pressures and then you remove the wire. I mean, in any case, you remove the wire. If you keeping the wire in the side branch and then going to the highest pressure in the stent, in the main vessel, then the chances of stucking in the, I mean, entrapment of the wire is high.
Fine, sir. Point well taken, sir. So we'll move forward. So we'll move to Dr. Ravi's presentation now. Sir, you can go ahead with your presentation now. Take over.
Yeah. Thanks, Dr. Gaurav. Thanks for the opportunity given to me. Since they have given me as responsibility as moderator also. So I have selected actually few cases. I take the liberty of presenting few cases, but I will go quickly of few cases, and I will try to share the message from each and every case. And please, Bansal sir and Pandey sir and Bhagwat sir are all here. So I would be very happy if they can guide me further. So the topic is, all trifurcations are not the same. So of course, in next 10 minutes, I am going to show you few trifurcation, left main trifurcation cases. And all three are actually very unconventional cases. Normally, these all cases are sent for surgery, but unfortunately, none of them agreed for surgery. So we took them for surgery for angioplasty. And before taking the patient for angioplasty, we made sure that they should understand that we are taking a surgical case. And as the cases were unconventional, so approach in all these cases were also unconventional. Another thing which I want to tell you, that in those cases, we need to see the CD several times before entering in the cath lab. I mean, when you see the angiogram, you keep on seeing angiogram, several times before taking your final plan to enter inside the cath lab, and try to stick to your plan. I mean, you know the anatomy, you know the orientation of left main to LAD, ramus to LAD, ramus to circumflex. So try to stick to your plan until unless there is something big happens inside the cath lab and you need to change your plan. Another thing, that if you have an artery more than, I mean, guidelines say more than 2.25, but I would say if it is more than 2.5 millimeter diameter, then probably you would end up using a metal, I mean, putting a stent. So in trifurcation, you should try to put two stents. If you can manage one artery with just POBA, and if you think that artery is again 2.5 millimeter or more, then you have to fix all three arteries. Now the issue comes, then how we go, I mean, I'm showing you very different cases. All three are different. So this first case is actually an old male who has disabling angina. He underwent angiogram almost 6 years back. He advised for CABG, but surgery was a big fear to him and the family, so he declined. And this time also, before planning for an angio, he clearly said that I will not go for a surgery. I mean, we usually see this type of patients. So we did the angiogram, and then I share the images of angiogram. So this was the first shot. You can see the LAD is diseased up to the middle of the part, and there is a reasonable size ramus arising, which is also a proximal artery, which is diseased. And the right coronary artery is CTO, which is filling from the left system. So in this case, I will share two, three things. One, you see that left main is more or less healthy. If you see the size of the left main, the diameter is quite big, and the branches arising from left main are diseased, but the left main per se is not diseased. And in any case, the left main size and the LAD size are very dispersed. I mean, you can't plan to make a stent coming from left main to LAD or to ramus or to circumflex, and left main is healthy. So probably you will try to just peep inside the left main by fixing all three branches. Another thing, when you are planning to touch a left main, you need to make sure whether the right coronary artery is healthy or not, if it is a dominant artery. So if it is a dominant artery and the artery is diseased, then I would suggest that we should fix the right coronary artery first and then touch the left main. So we did in this way, we staged the procedure. First, we did the right coronary artery CTO angioplasty. And there were two overlapping stents which we put. These were 3.32 and 3.528. And the results were okay. So we moved to the left system in next sitting. These all were signed blue wires. And as a principle, whenever I cross my wires, so I try to size them also with the distal end of the marker. So it gives a fair idea about the stent length, which may be required. And as we were talking in the initial part of our discussion, we should make sure that we prepare the bed very nicely, because we can't take a chance that after putting the stent is not getting deployed, you are having under deployed stent. So that is a very, very bad situation, especially when you are dealing with such a situation. So we made pre-dilatation nicely with 210 balloon and after that 3.8 balloon. In all three branches, I mean, there was some cost constraint, so I used the same balloon in all three branches. And once we did this, then we start putting stents. So this is the left system, when you can see the two stents, one in the LAD and another in the ramus. And you can see that I am not coming protruding into the left main. I am keeping just my markers inside the left main. And once you make sure that your markers are nicely placed, you deploy the stent. And in this situation, I remove the third wire. And once we deploy it, then we put the third wire. So you can see that the LAD and ramus are looking nice now. And now I take my third stent for circumflex. this left main is actually so petrolous that it is giving us very easy access to all three arteries. And once you are doing this, then you have two options. I mean, whenever you are doing a left main trifurcation, either you have eight French guide and you take three balloons together, or you take two guides, one maybe six, seven, or you can take 2-6, and you take three balloons all together and do tracing. I mean, tracing is you are taking three balloons together and keeping inflation of all three balloons together, which is not, I mean, practically feasible. And in this case, I know that my left main is very healthy. So, and these stents are actually not hugging each other. So just to make sure, we did the kissing in this way, that first we did kissing between the circumflex and the ramus, and next time we did kissing in the LAD and ramus. This is how we do, I would say, that sequential kissing. And once we are done this, this was the final result. So the patient is doing well. This procedure probably I did almost 1.5 years back. So this patient is doing well. So what I want to give in this small case, that first we need to make them understand that we are dealing a surgical case. That is very, very clear. I mean, we should not, I mean, these are cases which we have very, I mean, technical demanding, plus you use a lot of metal. So the chances of restenosis is also high. So we should make sure that the attendants and the patient, they should know this thing. I mean, you should not get a bad name that you are doing a complex case and the restenosis happened, because we should make genuine efforts to make the patient and their relatives understand that this is a surgical case. If there is some high risk situation for surgery or the patient is not willing, but still they should know this. Another thing, the message which I want to give in this case, that first fix the right coronary artery if it is diseased and then plan for a left main. Third, if you have a discrepancy between the left main and the branches, then every time including the left main with a stent may not be necessary, as we did in this case. And third thing, and the last thing I would say, tracing. Tracing is for three balloons together, either keeping a eight French guide, which is honestly speaking not easily available nowadays, and or keeping two guides, one is 6 and 1 and 7. So I go to that. Yeah,
Ravi,
yeah.
Ravi, just Dr. Ravi, just hold on. We have two questions on this.
Yeah, please.
One is just leave about tracing. Did you ever thought that you could deploy the three stents together by taking two guides? Did you thought about that?
Yeah, I thought of that.
Then,
but do you think
that would have been slightly better, because they say that sequential kissing do compromise one or the other stent?
I again go to the images, so probably I can share my take on this. Yeah, even in this way, you can make out that actually the circumflex is arising separately. I mean, this is by definition trifurcation, but I will go to the, I mean, the tricky thing which I thought that I can get away with this. Yeah, probably this view you can make out. Yeah, can you see? In this view, you can see.
Yeah.
Yeah, I will go step by step.
It is almost like a millimeter separate origin of
Yeah.
Arc.
Yeah. Yeah.
From the left main, from the LAD diagonal bifurcation. In this scenario, I think what you did will be fairly acceptable and fairly safe. But if the it's a true trifurcation, then I agree with Gaurav that probably you may not do what you have done right now.
I agree.
Sir, one more question: does the panelist have any other choice? Means any other technique except what Dr. Ravi has done? Do we have any other option of doing this case differently? Anybody want to share that it can be done in some other way also?
Yeah, actually, I would like to make a point. You know, in such a situation, I would definitely avoid doing anything to the ramus. At the most, I would do LAD or the circumflex, because you know a lot of metal comes at the distal left main by trifurcation. And ramus, agreed, it's not a very small vessel, but then, you know,
doing only LAD and circumflex would probably be a safer option in this situation. And I don't know, about the long-term results of such cases. And his patient is doing quite well, but you know, sometimes it could be a very tricky issue to exactly catch the ostium in such such cases. Dr. Gupta has done an excellent job in this. There is no question about the angiographic result, but sometimes it could be a very, very tricky issue. In this situation, sometimes if you have imaging, you can probably, do a left main two LAD stent and then put a, treat it as a bifurcation and do it.
This is what, sir, some European operators suggest, that you convert a trifurcation into bifurcation to get the best results long term.
Correct.
Don't treat as a trifurcation, convert it to bifurcation.
Because it becomes, too complex a situation just outside the left main ostium, left main bifurcation.
The issue is for the long term. If he develops a restenosis, it will be, no for a plasty probably.
See, the advantage in this case is that the left main is very short.
Yes, sir.
Therefore, probably whatever has been done is justified.
Very short left main.
Right.
Yeah, it's a short left main. Thank you very much, sir. And actually, I start with this notion only, that I would prefer to put two stents and try to do ballooning of the third artery. This is a whole idea.
Bansal, my question is, how would the length of left main matter? I mean,
because if the left main is just 1 to 2 millimeters,
yeah,
it is practically you have got three separate orifices.
Yeah, but at the same time, but you are putting the stent beyond the left main, beyond the distal left main. So what I'm trying to say is,
so it is like, you are not really doing a bifurcation. You are individually stenting each artery, though at the same time.
Yes, sir. This is what I said, that it's actually the stents are peeping inside the left main. As if the stents are peeping inside the left main. So you make sure that the stents are well open, and when the whatever part of the stent inside the left main. So these stents are at the max. I mean, the circumflex branch is altogether separate origin. But when we talk about the LAD and ramus, they are close. So you make sure that you do a proper kissing. So the proximal part of the struts of both stents, they don't interfere with each other. This was the whole idea of sharing this.
You have, three openings in the left sinus.
Yes, sir. It was something like this. Should I go on my next case?
Yes, sir. Dr. Ravi, please go on.
Dr. Gaurav, you wanted to say something else?
No. I'm just saying nice cases. Just go on to the other case.
Okay. So another case is almost similar history. Patient has typical angina, although he has absolutely normal ECG, normal echo. But the history which he has, I advise him for a coronary angiogram. And this turned out to be the angiographic pictures. This is the severe triple vessel disease. You can see the right coronary artery also diseased, but you can say either it's a early bifurcation of right coronary artery and the smaller branch has some disease. So in this case, probably I am not planning to do the right coronary artery, and I would try to fix the left system only. So this is my plan, to fix the left system and not doing anything for the right coronary artery. This is how we started. These are the images. You can see the proximal part of the circumflex is very tight, and the arteries, ramus is also a big size artery, and LAD ostium is also diseased. And the left main is also diseased in the distal part of it. So now my plan is to fix left main also. So in this situation, again, the similar fashion, we balloon all three branches. And for the safety, I kept the intra-aortic balloon pump also in place. So after, again, proper bed preparation was done, with all three arteries were ballooned nicely with 2.5 and then gradually to 3 millimeter balloon. And after this, I made sure that I put a stent from left main to LAD and I removed the wire. I mean, that is my practice. So I remove the wire always. And I always make sure that iliocranial view is going to help me to ascertain that my left main ostium is also covered. So in this view, you can make out that we are sure about the distal part of the stent and the proximal part of the stent. And then we go ahead. And after doing this, we take two more stents. And in this view, this is again, I would say we need to go in very detail, very minor detail of this. Then I'm keeping two stents. And you can see that the left main is dividing into actually two, LAD and circumflex. And the ramus is arising from the circumflex, as if it is arising from the circumflex, although it is a trifurcation. So when you see the stent placement, in this situation, you will see that my circumflex stent is slightly inside the left main and ramus is slightly distal. And in this position, we deploy these stents. And once we are done with these stent deployment, then again, in the similar, of course, we do kissing off all the stent, but for just to save my frames, I'm not showing those images. So these are good size balloons. And this is again ballooning of LAD and ramus, and this was circumflex and ramus. So this is how, and after this, we take a pot with a 4-0 balloon. It was a 4-6 balloon, I suppose. So once we are done with this, then this was the final. In this view, probably you can make out that ramus is arising not from left main, it's arising from circumflex.
So what you are trying to say is behaving like a high OM and not
It is something like a high OM, not like a ramus.
So this is one point which you said that you always remove the wire. Now the one advantage of removal of that wire when you are stenting from the ostium of the left main to the LAD is that sometimes the wire gets up when you are trying to remove that jigged wire, the guide tends to go in and cause longitudinal stent deformation of the ostium of the LAD stent near the ostium. That is the biggest disadvantage. But when you have pre-dilated the vessels with balloons, all the three, I would be a little hesitant because sometimes when you are going in again, you might raise a rock at the ostium of the left main, at the ostium of the circumflex in particular. And it will be very difficult and nasty to enter the circumflex again. So yes, I would be a little hesitant. Dr. Bansal, what is your opinion, Dr. Ajit?
It is very dangerous to cross a dissected artery. Once that too after dilatation. Sir, what do you say, Bansal, sir?
I would have left the wires. There is no reason why you should pull out the wire because as you said very rightly, since we are not doing the imaging, a small dissection would be a big trouble. So therefore, once you have made it absolutely roomy, all the three arteries, and you are doing sequential stenting, I think there is no need that you should necessarily pull out the wires.
Okay, sir, do you have any other option? Do you feel it can be done differently in some other way?
Yes, it can be done.
Miss, what do you feel? This is the best approach or we could have opted like DK Crush for LAD Circ and then, treating ramus as a side branch, we could have done before or after?
Your second choice is a better choice that you do the LAD Circ and then through the Circ you do the high OM.
Exactly. Because it is different. It's not coming from the trifurcation. It's from the circumflex. It's high OM like.
Yeah, it is high OM.
Because I am only concerned that in long term, these V or tap technique, don't do too well. Sir, what do you suggest, sir?
I think there was an RCT comparing DK crush versus this kind of a technique, and clearly the mace at 1 year, 30 days and 1 year also are far much less with the DK. So I know Dr. Ajit can opine on that or Dr. Bansal can opine on that.
Well, I think you're right. You know, one way of doing this case is, you know, do a crush between LAD and circumflex, and your OM is coming from the circ, that early OM, and you can do a tap there as the last step. But you know, doing left main to LAD and then doing two taps after that, maybe a little you know, I'm not too sure about the long-term results in such a situation.
Sure. So now, coming back to what you said, see, Bhagwat said earlier that it is not necessary to do the ramus. I think that would apply in this case more aptly, because if you look at that OM1 or ramus, whatever you want to call,
yeah,
the lesion is not as severe. It is predominantly circumflex lesion, followed by the LAD lesion. And the ramus or the OM1, whatever you want to call it, has a much lesser lesion. So even if you did the LAD and the circumflex by the DK crush technique, probably the patient would have done as well.
Yes, sir. Probably I was more enthusiastic in treating this.
We all learned that way only.
But other thing, Ajit, in this scenario, rather than doing left main to LAD first, as you said, left main to circumflex first.
Yeah.
That way, because the angle between that is far more worse than the angle between left main to LAD. So what is your take on that?
Well, if you want to do DK crush, then...
Yes, DK crush, I'm talking about.
Yeah, if you want to do a DK crush, then, you know, I think doing a left main to circumflex as stent, you know, put a stent in the LAD, crush it and put a stent from left main to circ is definitely an option. There is no question. And I think that is preferable.
Dr. Ravi, I just wanted to ask a small thing. You did mention that you see the CD is quite give good time to the CD evaluation technique discussion. Did you search the net also, my internet, about the trifurcation technique?
Unfortunately, Dr. Gaurav, we don't have much data on trifurcation.
That is what I'm coming to. Have you heard of Kurdistan technique?
Which technique?
Kurdistan. There's a very nice paper on trifurcation.
Sorry,
a small country north of Iran, and there's a Dr. Mirza. Okay. He has published a case report of 40 cases done with IVASOL with trifurcations, all trifurcation, very good technique.
Okay.
And just go through that. I have that technique with me. I have the paper with me. You just go through it. You love that technique.
Definitely. I would love to. Can you
mail that paper to us?
Sir, I have a presentation with me. I'll just share it after him.
Yeah.
Dr. Ravi.
Sure.
Go on with your third case.
Yeah. So I go to the third case, and the third case is a young male, again not ready for surgery because he lost one relative during CABG. I mean, this is again a very practical region that patient don't agree for surgery. Those who have lost some patient in surgery, they don't agree for surgery. Those have probably lost some patient during angioplasty, they don't agree for angioplasty. So this particular patient didn't agree for surgery, and ultimately I had to take him for angioplasty in this manner. And this was his angiogram. This angiogram is different from what we have seen earlier. I mean, you can see it's a long tubular left main, which is more or less healthy, except the distal part of it. I mean, most of the left main is healthy, and all three arteries arising from this left main are of almost equal size and all are diseased. So this is how it looks like. You can see the distal left main is diseased. It's a big ramus which is covering the whole of the left lateral wall. And you can see the LAD disease up to here, and the circumflex, which is also disease. This was the angiogram. So in this case, again wiring the arteries and pre-dilatation, preparing the bed, it's the same for which we have done in the earlier cases. Here I try to see that which artery is more in continuation with the left main. So I thought that the ramus, which is actually in continuation with the left main. So we plan to put a stent from left main to ramus and plan to do the T stenting in both LAD and circumflex separately. So this is how we put a stent. This is 322 from left main to LAD, to ramus. And during deployment, I removed the wires. And this was slightly tricky. So to recross the wires. So, but you can see that the branches arising slightly different angle. I mean, LAD is arising slightly distal to the origin of circumflex. So once we recross the wires, and after recrossing, then we put the LAD stent, and LAD stent is 2.7538. And while putting the stent, I am keeping a dilated balloon in the left main to ramus. It's something like a tap. And we make sure in different views that we are positioned nicely. After doing this, we come on another branch. Now we come to the circumflex, and in the similar fashion, we put a stent in the circumflex and keeping the balloon in left main to ramus. This is how we fix this trifurcation. This is actually a true trifurcation case, and the strategy was, I mean, slightly unconventional. So once we are putting all three stents, then we try to do kissing. And in this kissing, I tried that when we are kissing between the ramus and circumflex, my balloon should not encroach up to the LAD. So, and I took advantage of the origin of these arteries slightly apart from each other. So once we have kissing from ramus and circumflex, my small balloon is up to here only. And once I am done this, then I do the similar fashion here. So this is how we make sure that we, I mean, this is just assumption, and end result was okay. That's why I was comfortable. So this was the final result. This was the final result. You can see that these arteries are arising separately, and the idea of putting left main to ramus stent was slightly different, which I wanted to discuss with you all, and I want to, of course, learn from Bansal sir and Pondé sir and Bhagwat sir that should we always take LAD as a continuation of left main, and always we should plan a stent from left main to LAD, or we should plan some other?
I think my argument in this case would be the same. Again, here we're having you like tap technique probably.
Yes, sir.
So what you have done is you have put a stent from left main to ramus, and then two taps from each side.
Yes, yes sir.
So there are the two, you know, two lines of metal which are hanging in the left main, one from this side, one from this side.
Yes, sir.
You know, which in left main area, I don't know whether it could be very safe. You know, I have read one paper where you have, when you deal with such trifurcations, you treat them as two bifurcations and treat them. You know, you go with treat ramus LAD bifurcation as one, treat it as one bifurcation, then come back and treat the other bifurcation. So, you know, the only concern I have is leaving free metal in distal left main like this. If it is an LAD diagonal, tap is all right. In a circumflex OM, it is okay. Two taps from one from each side in a left main, which is not very big, is something which I am concerned about. That's the only thing I would like to mention. But otherwise, sir, technically you did a good job.
Sir, what other you will suggest decay crusher again?
Yeah, you take circumflex, you take Ramus LED as one bifurcation, treat it, and then come back to the second. Treat Ramus and circumflex as second bifurcation. So that's something which has been now more in vogue, rather than this area of confluence is particularly dangerous. That's what I think. Particularly when the size of the vessels is not very big.
Yeah.
They are 2.5, 2.6, 2.7 type of vessels.
Yeah, Bhagwan sir, I have one question. If you allow me, should I go to the images again?
Yeah.
In fact, what you said, I'm not able to understand that when you said that two bifurcation you would like to do.
Yeah.
I mean, LED and Ramus.
Take LED and circumflex, but treat by decay crush. Okay. Like straight. And then Ramus, you can use your tap as you did in your last case. So that would be the easiest way of doing this case. That's what I feel, because then you will have very little metal in that area, free metal in that area, because otherwise it becomes little tricky. That's what I just imaging here, right?
I agree with you, sir. And in fact, this patient luckily is also doing well. And we did OCT in this case also, but I'm sorry, because of the limitation of the space, we could not include this, but your point is well taken. And I understand that if we take two stents, one is left main to LED, I suppose. Bhagwan sir, you want to say?
Yeah, I mean, you treat
left main to LED and circumflex, like in DK Kush.
Correct.
And then we fix. We consider Ramus as a branch of LED, and then we do tap.
This is what. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
In fact, the Ramus is the most straight vessel from the left main. So
yes,
fix,
sir.
That would be the easiest at the end.
Yeah.
Okay.
If you see, it is in the same straight line almost.
Yes, sir.
You took the reverse, that you fixed up the Ramus first.
Yes, sir. Actually, now the case is over, so now we can discuss this. But I understand that crossing from Ramus stent to LED and to circumflex was actually a challenge.
And then when you do post-dilatation in such cases, sometimes it's difficult to pass the balloons for post-dilatation, because then there is some metal protruding inside. And then, to pass a stiff balloon, a non-compliant balloon for post-dilatation is sometimes not only difficult, sometimes could be risky, because it can deform that stented area.
Fully agree with you, sir.
That part of the stent which is projecting inside the left main.
Yes, sir. So in fact, yes, I wanted to share few trifurcation cases in the symposium. So that's why I picked up these different cases, and I'm very happy that we are discussing on those cases and coming up with new idea, learning from you all. Dr. Gaurav, you want to make some comment on these trifurcation?
Yes, Dr. Ravi, only thing, ask even the panelists that a role of FFR, like Sir Bhagwan sir said, that you convert into two double bifurcation, and then is there role of FFR in this?
Honestly speaking, when FFR came, we used it a lot. But believe me, I mean, this is my personal opinion. Of course, I'm talking on a scientific forum. I don't have much faith on FFR as a technique, because honestly speaking, you can make out whether the lesion is significant or not. I mean, probably your question in this case is...
I'm not debating about the significance. I'm debating that if FFR comes negative after two stent, you can even leave the third stent, what sir was saying, that you can do tap later.
I understand. If I would have done FFR, I mean, after putting two stents, I am doing FFR on the third artery, and that is negative, then definitely I would have left it.
See, the thing is,
So the thing is, like when you are doing the LED diagonal bifurcation, the kind of bifurcation, the second case was where the diagonal was looking a shade bigger than the LED. And let us say the person adopts a provisional stenting strategy because the diagonal ostium was not that badly involved. So you do a provisional stenting of the main vessel, you do everything possible, you do a final case. After that, if there is a little bit of diagonal ostial pinching is seen, or little bit, as long as there is good flow, there is no angina, there are no ST segment changes, you leave them alone. But suppose there is a significant pinching and there is no angina, there is no ST segment change, there people advocate FFR, and the FFR is less than 0.8, more than 0.8, leave it alone. The same way here, particularly when you are talking about a lot of metal coming into the distal lip, when if you would have treated the ramus with an FFR with normal flow and no chest pain, probably that would have been from long-term point of view, an ideal scenario. That is what people assume. Nothing else. Otherwise, the case has been done very well. No problem.
In my personal practice, let me tell you, ramus, I rarely chase ramus unless it's a very big vessel. If circumflex and LED are to be addressed, address those main vessels. And ramus you address as a last vessel only if it is of very significant size. And as I mentioned, you can do either an FFR or do a tap at the end.
Sir, I agree with you. Actually, fortunately, unfortunately, these all three cases have, to me, a sizable ramus. That's why I chased them. Probably, I would also behave the same. I mean, of course, LED is the most important artery. Then circumflex, if it is dominant. And ramus, at times we don't even see ramus. I mean, I fully agree with you.
No, but in this case, your ramus was really big. If you see really big the and view, it's the ramus is doing the function of supplying all the lateral wall. Just go back to the picture and see the LED has only septals. LED has no diagonal.
Yes, sir.
All diagonal function is being played by the ramus.
No, in this case, I agree. Ramus is a very big vessel. I was talking in general. If you see,
yes, I agree with you. And particularly if the ramus is only a 2 or a 2.25, right, it is better left alone.
Yeah.
Sir, actually, I just wanted to show you one interesting thing in the last frame. You can see the muscle bridge in ramus. So this actually ramus is supplying also. I will show you the last frame. Yeah. Can you see a muscle bridge here? Can you see a muscle bridge here? A muscle bridge in this part. So this has some intramuscular cores. This part is muscle bridge. I don't know how much this is clear to you all. But to me, this ramus looks big.
No, it is big, no doubt.
Yes, sir.
It's a big artery.
Dr. Ravi, one more small question.
Yeah, please.
You never felt that imaging should be done in these type of cases?
Yeah, I did imaging in this case. In earlier two cases, I could not perform imaging. I mean, as Dr. Bansal sir said, and Ponde sir said, imaging is feasible in somewhere around 10-15% cases, not more than that. I am working with Vocard, but still, the patient clientele may be slightly better financially, but when you are coming to hardcore, billing, then imaging is one thing which you have to subtract first. I'm sorry, I don't know how much the forum will agree on this.
Sir, Ponde sir, what do you say?
See, Gaurav.
Sir.
Let me share something with you about the imaging business.
Yes, sir, one sir, please.
I have got an in-house IVUS which the government has provided us.
Right, sir.
Catheters.
Right, sir.
And we are doing almost about 60% cases under the MPJY scheme.
Exactly, sir.
We need only 60,000 rupees for doing a single vessel angioplasty.
I know, sir.
IVUS catheter costs 52,000. So, in between, we try to do some additional by asking the patient to pay for the IVUS and the rest be paid by the government. So we face a lot of flack from the government. Exactly. That you can't do this. So even though I was trying to push up the IVAs, and we used to call the OCT on call, and last year we did about 150 OCT by calling OCT on call. But then the government authorities took us for a ride. You can't do this, make the patient pay a penny more than what the MP Devai permits. So, you know, only the self-paid patients are made to undergo the imaging. So financial constraints is the biggest. It is not the technology. See, putting in the IVUS catheter or putting in the OCT catheter demands only another 8 to 10 minutes, nothing more than that. And you have a whole wealth of information of what to do and where to stop. So there is no doubt about the utility of these modalities. It is only underutilized in our country, particularly because of the cost issue.
Sir, I agree, but the cases what sir is showing, Dr. Ravi has shown, they must be paid patient. Dr. Ravi, is it? Yes, they were paid patients.
What happened? Yeah, actually, two of my patients, old patients, they both were central government health scheme patients. Okay. So, I mean, you know, in central government health scheme, you are only allowed to use two stents.
Okay.
So the third stent, you need to ask them to pay for extra. And the third patient was a cash patient, but he has some limitation. I made him convince that we need to go for this. But believe me, Dr. Gaurav, normally what happens whenever we are planning to, when we give the cost to the patient or their relatives, it may be high for them, or somebody would ask for a bargain. So the only thing, or I would say the first thing which you'd like to, I mean, you are left with option. Okay, I was planning that I will do OCT in this case, or I will use IVUS in this case. Okay, I won't do IVUS, and now I can do this case with this much cost. I mean, this is practical I'm talking. I don't know. Bansal sir or Ponde sir, agree with me.
You're talking a sense, because moment you will say OCT, you are going to earn 1 lakh rupees more.
Yes, sir.
The patient may not be ready to pay.
Yes, sir.
Even though you are working at Wockhardt or any other private hospital.
Yes, sir.
Many times, even if the patient can pay, they want to save cost. And moment you say no, yes, your sir. Next colleague is ready to do the case without those.
Without imaging. sir, there are two questions in the chat box. Can we take them quickly?
Yes.
Yes, sir. There is a question from Dr. Rizwan. He says that what will be your bailout strategy in case of like in the first case when you did three V type of stenting? What will be your bailout strategy if there is a left main dissection with one stent deployment? What will you do?
Putting one more stent.
And the way, from where to where?
Yeah, of course. When you have dissected left main, I mean, whenever you are touching left main. First thing which I always keep on telling, that you should not be frightened, never pull out your wire. So keep your wire inside, and if you have an access, then first thing you should do, if you have a dissection with a balloon, then don't take out that balloon. Keep this balloon there only, and put the same balloon there and inflate it for some time, then deflate, because you are dealing with left main. So, I mean, you can't throttle the left main by putting a balloon. And most of the time, even if you have a dissection in the left main, I had few cases, one case which ultimately landed up with a left main dissection, and we had to put a stent there. And believe me, almost always putting another stent, I mean, you don't require a covered stent in those situations. If you have a perforation, I mean, there is a difference between a dissection and a perforation. The dissection means you have broke up two layers, the endothelium and the mesothelium. This is how the dissection happens. And if you perforate the adventitia also, the external layer also, then it becomes a perforation. So in perforation, you may rush for a surgery or a covered stent. But when you have a dissection there, putting another stent would be sufficient if you are not able to handle it with a prolonged balloon dilation.
Sir, there's one more question from the panelist.
Yeah, please.
That in your trifurcation cases, like the last one, how about two stents for LAD and CERC and a DEB for MS? Dr. Rajesh Badani wants to ask.
Very good option. Actually, Now, I would say that when I see these cases again and again, believe me, I also keep on thinking that probably putting two stents would have been better and using one DEB, because we have good experience with DEB now, and people are using DEB very, very frequently in bifurcation cases. I mean, even if your side branch is of good size, if you are having a healthy ostium by putting a Drago tube balloon, I'm very, very good, well taken point. Well taken point.
Any other suggestions, sir? Thank you, Dr. Ravi. Excellent presentations. Dr. Bansal, sir, Bhagwat, sir, Bonde, sir, any suggestions, sir?
No. Thank you. Thank you.
So, can I just show two slides for that Kurdistan technique?
Yeah, please.
Yes,
please.
Yes.
Please.
Sir, please share my screen.
Please, Dr. Ravi.
You can see the slides?
Yes, see.
Yeah, we can see your slides.
Sir, this is a paper which was published in 2014. You can see that it's known as Kurdistan technique for triple trifurcation. And he has shown a case report also how he does this. The author is Dr. Aram Mirza. And what he do is that you can see there's a typical left main trifurcation, what the kind of cases Dr. Ravi has shown. He puts one stent from left main to LAD, a big stent, usually slightly oversizing the LAD. Then he do pot into the LAD, then take two small stents into the circumflex and ramus. He deploy it simultaneously, keeping a balloon in the LAD, so that the LED balloon doesn't get crushed. And finally, he comes out with a simultaneous kissing between all the three branches. And he has done all these cases, around 30 to 35 cases, with IVUS guidance. And 5-year follow-up is good for him. This is the final result.
This is wonderful, Gaurav. Actually, I believe this is what we call trissing. Bansal sir, am I right?
It just sounds interesting.
Yeah,
it's well documented with IVUS, and the 5-year follow-up is quite good. So many people are now adopting this technique for bigger ramus, like your third case in which the ramus was as good as LED.
Yeah, and which guide he has used in this?
Eight French.
Yeah, of course. I mean,
there is no option for 8 French in this, because you are taking 3 balloons at the same time at the end.
Yes, sir.
After doing the pot for the left main, right? So
right,
it has to be an 8 French guide.
Right, sir.
Sir, another option which we are left with is taking two guides. One is 6 and another is 7. That also can serve the purpose.
But then access side problems and all those things, that will happen.
Yeah, you have to fix both the femorals. Yeah.
French is a better option, yeah.
But 10 French means you'll have to tell the company fellow in advance to get the...
Yes, it's not available, sir, nowadays. You have to specially order it.
It's impossible to get it,
Yes, sir. Yes.
So, thank you very much.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. It has been a very nice, elusive and very, learning experience for all of us. And I thank all the faculty for sparing so much time for us. And any comment, final comment from anybody around? Dr. Sau, sir, you are there? Dr. Shetkar, you want to say something to finish off?
Yeah, well, very nice cases, especially the last three cases of this trifurcation. It had lots of learning. And Kurdistan technique, I knew the word, but thanks for showing the technique exactly. It's much simpler.
Yeah. And good thing is that it's well documented, good follow-up. So that is more important for us, that we can, safely do it.
I read the paper some days before. I think it's not doing the simultaneous kissing of all these three stents together. I think they do it sequentially. Then ramus, that.
No, left main to LAD first. Then pot up the left main, right?
Yes, sir.
The left main.
No, sir. Bonde, sir, he put the stent from left main to LAD first. Right. And then while putting the stent in ramus and circumflex, he kept a balloon in the LED.
LED.
Yeah.
And while doing the final kissing, it was actually a trissing.
Yes,
I mean,
sir.
He had three balloons and he did it from 8 French. So he could negotiate 3 balloons from 8 French guys.
Sir, it is always safe, you know, to keep a balloon in LED because LED is a main branch. You cannot compromise that.
Yeah, that's the point I want to say. In the paper, it is mentioned that it is not done simultaneously. They do it sequentially. Like left main to Ramus kissing is done first. Then Ramus to circumflex kissing. Like I think we should read the paper. I think.
Now, Sudhir, the images which Dr. Gaurav shared, it shows three balloons together.
I just share it again. Just see.
Yeah, please.
That was regarding deployment of the stents, I think.
No. This is the final kissing. Yeah. See this image. See this image. You have one balloon here. One and you, can you go to the last slide?
Yes.
No. After the. Yeah, no. Before this.
You know, in some cases, he has done what Dr. Shetkar is saying, that sequential as well.
Okay.
Yeah, you can see this.
Because in the article, it is mentioned sequentially. In the PDF file.
You can see the slide?
No, it's not getting shared.
No. Just a minute.
Yeah, screen is not shared, Dr.
Just a minute. Now you can see?
Yeah.
Now you can see that he has used three balloons and simultaneously has done the triple kissing.
And what I believe that we can get good result, I mean the best result in trifurcation with tracing only.
Yes.
I mean, if it is a real trifurcation.
We are just scared that no stent should get somewhat compromised whatsoever. Yeah.
Definitely.
So I'd like to thank everybody. All of you have participated very nicely. We are very happy and we have learned a lot today. Thank you, Dr. Ravi. Thank you, all the panelists, and special thanks to our chairperson. Sir, any final comments, sir? Bansal, sir? Ponde, sir?
Thank you.
No, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Then we'll end the session and it's quite fruitful and we learned a lot. Thank you all. Bye for now. We'll again meet someday.
Thank you, Dr. Gaurav.
Thank you.
Sir, can you unshare your screen?
Sure.
Everyone, thank you, Dr. Gupta, for all the lovely cases. Thank you, Dr. Bansal, for informing us about so many things. Thank you, Dr. Shetkar. Thank you, Dr. Singla, Dr. Sahu. Thank you all viewing. We wish you a very good night. And tomorrow we have a couple of more sessions. We would want you to join back into Hall A. We have a couple of sessions on left main PCI and a session on recent advances in antiplatelet therapies in PCI. So hope to see you all tomorrow. Thank you. Good night.
Yeah, thank you.
At the heart of what we do is exploring limitless possibilities to enrich lives all over the world. Life is precious, and we're in the business of cherishing every precious heartbeat. Every day brings a new reason to better our lives. Something to learn. Something to laugh and enjoy. Something to dream. For as long as there's a dream, there's hope. And as long as there's hope, there's joy in living. Reasons for us to keep every heart happy and healthy. Helping us in our endeavor are the many interventional cardiovascular solutions that we create. At our state-of-the-art facilities, we make our stents and catheters. Wires and needles. German excellence and Indian innovation, backed by credible research. With the unmatched advantage of being the only company with clinical trials data spanning over 10 years for efficacy and safety. And a one-of-its-kind partnership with the German Heart Center, renowned for its pioneering advancements in cardiovascular technologies. It's not surprising we have over 5,000 satisfied clients and a million smiling patients in over 50 countries around the world. We trust good things happen when you follow your heart, because there's an ocean of opportunities to discover. And our journey has just begun. Translumina, exploring limitless possibilities of life.